I was astonished that anyone in this day and age was playing that way. And it's like, oh, well, thank God, you know, some young guy is playing like that. And apart from that, there was the singing and the writing. So I wanted to meet him as soon as possible. And when I came to LA to do the B.B. King album, I asked him if he would like to collaborate on just play on the floor, and we'd work out how to do it as we went along, you know. I just wanted to meet him. And he's the real thing, you know. I mean, the first thing I noticed physically was he had Lightning Hopkins tattooed on his arm. And I mean, that's a serious commitment for a start, you know. And I just had tremendous respect for him from the word go. And he can play, he's a real player. You know, and there are only a handful blues players that are really the real thing, but he knows the genre, and I don't know how that happens. I mean, you can study all your life and still only know it intellectually, but he knows it from inside somehow.
It started with Jimi Hendrix and Little Wayne. Then came Slow Hand himself, Eric Clapton. Texas would bring the blistering guitar work of Stevie Ray Vaughan. And now, the torch has been passed. It's our generation's turn. And again, he will come from Texas. He's performed and recorded with Sheryl Crow, Roger Waters, and Eric Clapton. And now, it's his turn. He's a long, long way from the crossroads. Doyle Bramhall II, live from the Great Wall of China.
Let me see, yeah. We can.
I wanted to tell him when he first started playing with me that I thought he ought to know that I'd never heard anyone like him, too. It's like, you know, at some point Stevie Ray stopped sounding like Albert King and sounded like Stevie Ray, and Doyle is the same. Nobody sounds like, he plays like nobody else, and yet it belongs in the genre, you know what I mean? It belongs in the genre, and yet it stands on its own.
Yeah. black milk in my cow won't come. I feel like churning in a milk won't turn, and I'm crying.
I had missed being in a band since I was in bands when I was younger with the Archangels. I always had somebody to play off of. I was sort of the foil, you know, in bands, and I didn't really have that. So I felt like there was a lot of pressure on me to be the sole front person of a band. And so I just wanted to get back to, you know, the band roots and just play and take the pressure off. So. And there's a kind of explosiveness to the band that I have, so it allows us to play three-piece in a way that is not really played anymore, you know, a la Cream, Jimi Hendrix, you know, all those bands that were Stevie that were playing three-piece that could pull it off, you know.
Bye.
Well, it was an amazing experience with Roger, because I think he was the guy that was behind the conceptual part of Pink Floyd. Well, it's been a very interesting road for me because, you know, I worked with Roger Waters separately from Eric Clapton, and Eric Clapton didn't know that I was working with Roger and vice versa. So when I hooked up with him, it was great because at the time I wasn't getting a lot of recognition as an artist, but I had rock stars calling me to play with them and sort of validating me and my records. I originally met Sheryl. It was actually through my manager, Scooter, who managed Sheryl at the time, and I was with the Archangels. And I think she had come to a show that the Archangels had played, so she knew of me. And Scooter was a fan of mine, so he sort of hooked us up originally. I think it was in about 94 or something. And he hooked us up, and you know, we just had total respect for each other's craft work, you know. And she's just been, you know, great for me because she's a big cheerleader for me, whereas there's not a lot of artists that I can think of that I'd want to have really championing me. Well, I didn't start playing guitar until I was 14, but I had always played music. But I think as soon as I picked the guitar up at 14, I started doing really badly in school. But I started making a lot of money playing music, and I thought I was so much better at playing guitar than doing algebra that I should stick with guitar.
We'll be right back.
cause it ain't buzzing. Little generator won't get that far. When the motor's in a bad condition, you need these batteries charged, and I'm crying, please. Since I've been gone, I'm gonna get down in this connection. Keep on tangling with these wires. Get down in this connection. Keep on tangling with these wires. And if I match down and hit your starter, then your spark plug to give me fire.
It's so tough on the fingers, this one. Because it's da 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 da. It's not just one, it's da da da.
So crazy.
But that was pretty good. For a minute. We'll be right back.
black milk in it, my cow won't come. I feel like churning in a milk won't turn, and I'm crying.
Scooter introduced me to Doyle. I mean, and sent me his first album, and I was astonished that anyone in this day and age was playing that way. And it's like, oh well, thank God, you know, some young guy is playing like that. And apart from that, there was the singing and the writing. So I wanted to meet him as soon as possible. And when I came to LA to do the B.B. King album, I asked him if he would like to collaborate on just play on the floor, and we'd work out how to do it as we went along, you know. I just wanted to meet him, and he's the real thing, you know. I mean, the first thing I noticed physically was he had Lightning Hopkins tattooed on his arm, and I mean, that's a serious commitment for a start, you know. And I just had tremendous respect for him from the word go, and he can play. He's a real player, you know, and there are only a handful blues players that are really the real thing.
When you say Doyle plays like that, what do you mean that? What's that?
I don't know. Okay. If you can't define it, it's the real thing. It's not like he plays from the heart, but he knows the genre, and I don't know how that happens. I mean, you can study all your life and still only know it intellectually, but he knows it from inside somehow.
He turns the guitar upside down, but he doesn't turn the strings.
But that's not it either, because I mean, that Stevie Ray did that, and so did Albert King. And it's not something he did. This is something he does. I mean, he can play either way, I think, but it's something more than that. I mean, and yet at the same time, he played like I wanted to tell him when he first started playing with me that I thought he ought to know that I'd never heard anyone like him, too. It's like it, you know, at some point Stevie Ray stopped sounding like Albert King and sounded like Stevie Ray. And Doyle is the same. Nobody sounds like, he plays like nobody else. And yet it belongs in the genre, you know what I mean? It belongs in the genre and yet it stands on its own.
All right, Mike. Why don't you tell us a little bit about you and how you came to work with Doyle and how you met Doyle?
I met Doyle about 3 years ago through a mutual friend, actually his sister-in-law, Wendy Melvoin, who I'd done a lot of session work with, thought we would be a good hookup. So I had told her that I was actually a big fan of Doyle's, and next thing I know, Doyle's called me on the phone about a week later saying we should get together and do some writing. We hooked up, and immediately it was just instant chemistry. You know, I think we come from a lot of the same places, musically as well as personally. And right off the bat, you know, you get a certain feeling when sometimes, you know, you meet people and you just know instantly you're going to click. And Doyle was one of those type of people.
To have Doyle come in with the music that I envisioned myself doing anyway.
Right. Yeah, you know, I've always wanted to do a variety of different types of music. I never wanted to get typecasted in just one genre. And someone like Doyle is great because he's got a whole range of different types of influences and different types of things that he likes to do as an artist. So for me, it was a perfect match, a perfect opportunity to get to try different things that are maybe going to be more rock, things that are going to maybe be more R&B and soul influenced, and just mesh it up, you know. And Doyle's voice, as well as his musicianship, he can pull anything off. The first day, actually, that we got together and met, we just kind of hung out maybe about an hour talking about what we've been doing and getting to know each other. And then I had a little bit of an idea that I kind of thought might be cool for him. And so I played it for him, and immediately he started coming up with some melodies, started adding some chords, and it actually went on to be the song that Clapton cut for his upcoming release.
Who does Doyle remind you of? I know that artists hate to be put in a box, but I mean,
right.
Did anybody, when you saw him sing or play, did anybody come to mind, or did you just think this was just...
You know, there's not one particular person that I could compare Doyle to. I think he's just this amazing combination of all these great artists over the past, and I'd say everyone from, you know, Stevie Wonder, Bill Withers, of course Jimi Hendrix, and a lot of all the great blues players. You know, he's just got he's kind of taken from all these amazing artists from the past and made an completely new sound, a completely different approach. You know, and to me, he's his own voice.
Now, you've been focusing more on producing, correct? And rock songwriting. Songwriting is what you've been doing a lot of lately.
Yeah.
Or do you still play live, and how did you come to be on the Great Wall concert with Doyle?
Well, I remember Doyle telling me, a while ago that he had a couple of shows coming up that he didn't really have a band set. So I just told him, I said, if there's any opportunity that I can get to do some live work, you know, whatever, you know, let me know. And we did a couple things. We'd played at the Dallas Crossroads Festival, and we had a great time at that show. And the next thing I know, he called me up and said, "I got this show coming up in China," which you don't hear every day. He asked if I would like to do it. And really, it was within a couple of weeks that everything had to be thrown together. And for me, it was a no-brainer, you know, to get to, you know, come and visit a place that I had never been to before, see a whole other way of life. In addition, you know, witness an amazing monument, you know, with the Great Wall, and then get to perform. I mean, to me, it seemed like all the right makings of an amazing trip. So basically, we just pulled it together within a couple of weeks, and next thing I know, I'm up on the stage with Doyle at the Great Wall.
Doyle, let's talk about the Robert Johnson recordings and how that all took place in the historical place that you actually did it.
The Robert Johnson sessions that I did with Eric were was an idea put together by Eric, because we were playing the whole Crossroads benefit and everything was sort of tied in at the time to the Crossroads Festival with basically all of his favorite musicians and guitar players. So because we were stationed in Dallas for about 3 weeks, he wanted to go to the original place that Robert Johnson recorded half of the catalog that he did. So it was about 15 songs were recorded in this one warehouse room in Dallas. And somehow he got it. It had been converted into an office space. But when we walked in for the first time, there was there were all these little stickers on the wall that were from 1930. And it still had the original memorabilia and things from that time that were still sort of hanging on the walls. So it was pretty eerie. And when we sat down to play, it definitely had this feeling of like we were intruding in somebody else's space. You know, like that building was chosen to be the place where they recorded that music, and that was sort of the home for that music. And but you know, Eric and myself felt like we were guests in you know, Robert's house.
When you played Terry playing blues, to be that technically proficient to play Robert Johnson and have the nuts to do that, I mean, had you and Eric rehearsed that at all, or did he just say step up and y'all did it?
You know, Eric is the kind of guy that, you know, when he gets it in his head to do something, he just goes after it, and he doesn't really care what obstacles are in the way. He doesn't think about anything. He just goes and he does it. So, I mean, he did tell me that we were going to do Terra Plane Blues and a couple other Robert Johnson songs acoustic, and when we did that, it took me about took me about a year of learning how to play that kind of style. Because it's not really something you can accomplish as one guitar player, as me and Eric found out later. It's so hard to do because basically it takes two guys, because Robert Johnson had a style where he would play the melody and the rhythm on the top half of the guitar, on the top strings. He would also be playing the rhythm and bass lines underneath, and those two rhythms were completely separate from each other. So you had two different things happening, and that's extremely hard to do. I mean, it might sound to the average listener like it's very simple, but when you try and do it, it cannot be recreated. So on top of that, you have two different, completely different guitar things that you're doing. He was also singing in a completely different cadence on top of that, and it was free from both. So you had three different things you're doing there. And it took Eric and me to try and emulate it as best as we could. And I'm sure that Eric agrees that it still didn't feel like we accomplished what one man did.
I thought it was unbelievable. Let's talk about how you and Eric hooked up, and how did that all, the whole process of the network of people that brought you and Eric together, tell me about that.
When I got together with Eric, it was sort of a strange phone call, because I was on the road with Roger Waters at the time, and the guitar player in Roger Waters' band was a man named Andy Fairweather Lowe, who also plays in Eric's band. But Eric didn't know that I was connected to Roger Waters in any way. So when he called me, he had just received a CD of mine, my second album, Jelly Cream. He received that, and he was in Japan touring, and he listened to it, and he found my number through my manager, who was a friend of his, who sent him the CD.
and he just asked for my number, and sort of out of the blue, Eric called me and said, hey, this is Eric Clapton. And I think I told him to get out of here, like, you know, yeah, whatever, man. And he said, no, really, it's Eric. It's Eric Clapton. I was like, oh, wow. And he said, you are my new favorite. You made my new favorite record in the last 5 years. He was like, you and D'Angelo made my two favorite records that have been put out recently. And he said, you know, I'm getting back in a couple of weeks, and I would love to get together with you because I love these two songs in particular, Marry You and I Wanna Be. He said that he wanted to record them on a new record that he was making with B.B. King, writing with the King. And so he asked me to come back and sort of show him, you know, how the songs went. And he said he was having a bit of trouble. And I think it was just because I play left-handed upside down that there are definitely things that I can play. And I use my thumb, whereas a right-handed guitar player couldn't do. So he was like, yeah, just come down and show me how they go or whatever. So I got together with him, and we talked a lot. We had a lot of things in common that we both didn't know about. And, you know, me growing up with Stevie Ray Vaughan and Jimmy Vaughan and his connection with both of those guys. So anyway, we got together, and he invited me down to the studio. And they were, I remember getting out of my Cadillac, walking into the studio, and as I'm walking in, I'm hearing I Wanna Be, one of my songs, being played. And as I walk into the control room, I look out into the floor, and I see B.B. King, Eric, and Eric's band playing one of my songs, and I hear B.B. doing his, you know, his B.B. riff over I Wanna Be, and it was just very, very trippy. And Eric saw me and said, hey, B.B. Doyle's here, let's get him in here. And he said, do you want to play? And I just walked on the floor and started to play with him, and I think it was two takes later we had that song done. And he just kept asking me to play on songs after we would finish. And I ended up doing the whole record, and then working with him after that on three other records as well.
Is it just a sense of I can't turn Eric Clapton down, even though your plans are put on hold as a solo artist or as a guy that's putting together the band, arranging, you know, or just, is that what it is? I can't say no to Eric Clapton, or did, was it like this experience too good to pass up as you're going to grow as a songwriter? I mean, but it does take away time from you writing and doing your own thing.
I think working with Eric is something that I don't even think about as far as, like, is it going to get in the way of my career or my songwriting? Because I think from what I learn from him is so important. And, you know, it's things that I can use for the rest of my career and life, personally and professionally, musically.
Did you get to sit down with Clapton, just the two of you, maybe in a hotel room and kind of deal, just kind of sitting around in rehearsals or whatever, and did that, how you got to did you write with him?
Yeah, I mean, I wrote with Eric on the last three records that we've done, and yeah, I mean, you know, he works fast. You know, Eric is the kind of guy that, like I said, he does something, he really knocks it out, and then he's on to the next, and he just likes to create, constantly create. And so, you know, if we sat down to write something, it would be, you know, it would happen in 10 minutes, because that's sort of the way that he works. He's just really quick, you know.
Was Cream an influence at all on the sound you were going for with Greenlight Girl?
I think Smokestack, in general, the band and the idea that I originally had for it was to play rock music in the sort of traditional form, not so old, but, you know, late 60s, early 70s, and to get that sound. And I don't think there are many musicians doing that. And not only that, but, you know, there's one thing to have the sound of it and to recreate the sound of it, but to do it in a way with great songs and being creative at the same time, you know, is really hard to do. That's what made those bands like Cream and Hendrix so innovative is because they had such amazing songs to go with this kind of guitar playing and just band situation. The power trio, but there were melodies flying around, and you know, it was just really strong all the way around.
Let's talk about how you came, how Sheryl became aware of Doyle. I know there's a lot of people out there are Doyle Bramhall fans, but how did the Sheryl thing come together, and how did you end up singing and playing on Steve McQueen and those other songs that are on that record?
I originally met Sheryl. It was actually through my manager, Scooter, who managed Sheryl at the time, and I was with the Archangels, and I think she had come to a show that the Archangels had played, so she knew of me, and Scooter was a fan of mine, so he sort of hooked us up originally. I think it was in about 94 or something, and he hooked us up, and you know, we just had total respect for each other's craft work, you know. And she's just been, you know, great for me because she's a big cheerleader for me, whereas there's not a lot of artists that I can think of that I'd want to have really championing me, you know. And she is definitely one, Eric is one, and Roger Waters being the other one.
How does it feel when you take on and do a song like that, especially coming from who you are?
Well, I got a phone call from Sheryl saying that she was going to play Austin City Limits, and they wanted to do something a little differently because they were filming outdoors, I think, for the first time, the Austin City Limits show. And when they called me, I think she wanted to do a cover of Pride and Joy, I think mainly for Lance, because, you know, it was a part of that whole thing, and Lance loved Stevie as well. And so she wanted to do Pride and Joy for him, but she couldn't think of any guitar players to play it and that would do it and, you know, do it justice. So she called me up and said, I want you to, you know, play on Pride and Joy. I'm going to do this for Lance. And when I got there, you know, I'm a little weird about covering Stevie's thing, just because, you know, I was so close to him, and I've been my own artist for so long that I'm not in a place to where I'm trying to cop his thing at all. And so I was trying to figure out how to do it in respect to him, but at the same time just do it the way I would do it and not worry about it. And so I had to tune basically an octave below what the song was, and I tuned all the strings. They barely, you know, stayed on the guitar. It was so low, but it was definitely fun.
A lot of artists that have had hit songs that they've been playing on the road forever, and that the fans just can't do without. You always got to find new inventive ways to make it fun for the musicians. And talk about that with Cocaine and Eric.
I think playing Cocaine with Eric was a great experience because he was saying that it had never sounded like that. In all of the years he'd played it, it sort of reinvented itself with the band that he had touring, which was different than any other band he had had before. So he was really happy about playing Cocaine live. And he was like, it doesn't really sound like Cocaine, but I love it. And I'm so glad that I love it.
It takes a young guy like you to get in there and make it fresh again, too. I mean, I'm sure he'd love that. Who were your initial influences as a player? I mean, when you were young, before you started coming into your own style, who did you sound like anybody, or did you always in your own mind sound like Doyle Bramhall Jr. too? Take it.
I think originally my biggest influence and what I tried to sound like was Stevie Vaughn and you know, all the Texas guys, because I was so close to it. I wanted to sound like a combination of Stevie and Jimmy Reed and John Lee Hooker. And those were sort of my guys that I learned from, which aren't, you know, by any guitar player standards, like great guitar players. They don't think of John Lee Hooker being a great guitar player, which I do. I think he is one of the best guitar players. And I think that Keith Richards and, you know, other people like that would agree with me that, you know, those are the, I really love songwriters more than I love guitar players. Guitar players don't really interest me if they can't write songs and make something out of it.
Who inspires you now as a songwriter? Anybody?
Who inspires me now? I'll have to take a second to think about it.
Let's do this. Do different tunings affect your writing style? I mean, you use five different guitars in the China Show.
Mm-hmm.
Do you pick up which one are your favorite guitars, and do they all give you a different feeling to write from?
Yeah, I mean, you know, when I write, I usually write on acoustic. That's always how it starts, and it's just, you know, by default, I have an acoustic in the house. I don't have my electric guitars there. So I usually start with that, or I'll just sing melodies, you know, into a little tape recorder or something, and then put music to it later. But I do like a lot of different tunings because, for me, because I didn't have a lot of formal training, I'm completely self-taught. And for me, if I'm playing in natural tuning, I seem to put a lot of boundaries on what I can and can't do, because there are proper things you can do and things that, you know, aren't necessarily, you know, right to play. And when I use tunings and I tune, you know, whatever tuning I use, I can sort of get out of that, and I have no boundaries to, like, oh, this is right or wrong, because I'm just going by what my ear hears, you know.
Let's talk about the future. What are your plans, and what new projects are you working on? And what can we expect to see from Doyle Bramhall II?
Well, I'm working on this new DVD of the China Show. And right now I'm sort of juggling the live CD, a DVD. I've been trying to hit as many things as I can, like working with an old band, the Archangels. And, you know, I've just been looking at a lot of artists that are having some success and are artists that I respect. And it seems like they're just taking it out of the hands of the sort of business people and just getting in there and, like, making cameo appearances and doing whatever, just creating, doing different band projects, doing all of that. So I have my hand in a lot of things right now that I'm putting together, but...
All right, let's do this. Here's your chance to say who you want to work with. Is there anybody out there that we want to talk about and say, hey, you know who I'd love to work with, you know who I'd love to play with, you know who I'd love to come to the studio with me, you know who I'd love to sing with, play with? Is there anybody like that that comes to mind to you now that you're getting to that place where you can pretty much call anybody?
Yeah, you know, if I could work with anybody, it's hard to say. I mean, because what I would do is work with people that made records in the mid-70s, and it really can't be done, you know? I mean, I've done it all, really. I've worked with Roger Waters, I've worked with Eric Clapton. As far as that goes, really, I just want to, I want to come onto the scene now with my own thing.
What do you use in your live rig? And do you prefer newer or older gear when you're doing live performances and recording sessions? Do you use all old stuff?
I like a lot of analog gear. I do like a lot of old pedals. A lot of the newer stuff is starting to sound really synthetic, and it's all digital. And, you know, there's some things that sound great, but for the most part, it's like I like old analog. I like them to look like old trash cans and just funky, you know?
Tell me the story about how Rennie Harlan and whoever was responsible for bringing Greenlight Girl to the movie Driven, and how you've been involved with certain soundtrack projects.
Sorry, one more time?
Tell me how the soundtrack project for Driven and Greenlight Girl came together.
I didn't even know what you were talking about. It's a really boring story.
Oh, it is? Okay.
I don't even know.
Were you excited about that when you saw it on the...
Not really.
Not really. Do you have any desire to score pictures?
Yes, I've actually done a little work scoring a couple of films. unfortunately didn't really go anywhere, just because it didn't go anywhere just because I went out on the road with Eric, so I had to choose if I wanted to stay home and like start scoring a little more or go on the road with Eric, and I chose the road with Eric, which I think was the right choice. But for me, it's pretty easy to think about scoring if I have somebody there that can do all the technical side of it and just leave me with the music and the scenes, because that's sort of how I write. I sort of score everything as I'm walking around all day long. That's what I do. So it's really easy for me to do.
Sounds like I got to interview Jeff Emmerich yesterday, who worked on Beatles records, and he sounds like somebody that would fit well with you, because he likes to work with unique artists that he can just turn on the machines and let you do your thing.
Right.
Whether it's taking a Coke bottle and picking up against the drum head or what.
Well, I've always wanted to make a blues record that sounded like the White Album, so if I could get together with him, that would be great.